I hope you enjoyed the last lunch for today. Also probably for the last conference for the next 2 or 3 months at least. So right by now we have a cool new talk from Marcel. Yesterday we saw the cool insight from how Giant Swarm handles the postmortems. Now he will show us how we can test Kubernetes operators. So probably you are also familiar with the concept of Kubernetes operators from the days before. So now Marcel will show us how you can test it at the end. So please give him a warm welcome. And so this is Marcel Miller's stage.
Thank you. So first, the title already gives it a little bit away. So there's a question mark at the end. So how testable are Kubernetes operators is mainly going to be the theme. Quickly to me, I'm Marcel. You saw me yesterday, maybe. I'm a platform engineer at Giant Swarm. So I mainly work in my day-to-day life on operators, developing operators, maintaining operators. And I also work very deeply in our RelEng infrastructure. So yeah, basically release engineering for operators as well and our platform. So the first thing you might have noticed is also Kubernetes operators. We talked about them quite a few times now at this conference. But what really are Kubernetes operators, right? We quickly glanced on it in a few talks, but I wanted to give another short introduction on like what are Kubernetes operators and what's important to me about Kubernetes operators. So this is quite an opinionated look at Kubernetes operators. So when I asked myself, what are Kubernetes operators? The first thing I take a look at is, what do the CNCF say are operators? So I went to the documentation for an operator definition, and this is in a short form what is there on the bottom. You will also have the link later on. So a Kubernetes controllers concept lets you extend the cluster's behavior without modifying the code of Kubernetes itself. We notice there's no operator word in there yet. So somehow there's another concept called controllers, and that's somehow different from an operator. And it goes on and tells us that operators are clients of the Kubernetes API that act as controllers. So somehow an operator is a specific type of controller or a specific class of controller, so to say. And they do it for a custom resource. So obviously now we kind of know, okay, an operator is a controller. We still don't know what a controller is. So the next logical step is we look at the controller definition. Again, we go to the docs and we figure out, okay, controller tracks at least one Kubernetes resource type. So that can now be a native resource type, like a pod, which you probably all know, and or a custom resource also. These objects have a spec field that requires the desired state. Now, this is where it gets interesting. So we have a desired state that's defined. No matter what the resource is that we are watching with our controller, that we want to fulfill most likely. And finally, the controllers for that resource are responsible for making the current state come closer to the desired state. So we somehow have a magical desired state that we want to reach, and the operator tries its best to make that desired state a reality in the current world. Now from there, we can obviously see, you know, okay, an operator is someone who acts like a controller, but compared to, for example, the controllers in the controller manager, which are now in this graphic would be on the master, they are outside of this. So they are clients of the Kubernetes API, which is also to an extent true for the controllers in the controller manager, but they run most likely outside of your master or can basically run anywhere, just consuming or interacting with your Kubernetes API. So that's one very important distinction when you look at it. Still, an operator internally can have multiple controllers that implement the controller pattern, so to call it. From now, we can basically look at, again, we said desired state is in spec. Current state is the reality, which we want to change so it matches our desired state. And this reconciliation is by applying a diff or taking some actions to get the desired the current state closer to the desired state. Now, in the controller pattern, this happens either periodically. So there can be, as you can see up there, observe Kubernetes as a list. or as a watch. The list operation would be what we call a reconciliation time. So for example, every 30 seconds, we track all the resources in our namespace or all the resources we are responsible for. We get all of them and then check, like, are they still equal to their desired state, or is the current state of each resource different from the desired state? So the operator needs to take action. That's what we describe as the reconciliation of an object that can happen every 30 seconds or however you want to configure that. And then, as I said, yeah, we evaluate whatever we observe from the Kubernetes API as the desired state against the current state, and we reconcile, which is basically we try to make the two states equal. Or better said, the operator tries to make them equal. So now let's take a little bit more applied look at this. We are outside, so we are a Kubernetes user right now. We can submit a custom resource, or first a custom resource definition, but later on a custom resource, which defines our desired state. The operator can receive events, or will receive events, of that desired state, and will take a decision and action to actually take this desired state closer to reality, or the reality closer to the desired state. Some examples. So there's two categories of operators, in my opinion, right now. You may disagree, but this is what I'm seeing in the community right now. First category is an operator that basically packages an application. That would be one example, Prometheus operator. Prometheus is an application that has to be deployed in your cluster. So we have a Prometheus operator that watches Prometheus CRs. Those CRs describe a desired state for my Prometheus deployment, and the operator tries to make that deployment a reality. Obviously, it's more complex than Prometheus operator, if you know the Prometheus project, but that's the gist of it. So again, we then see it continuously reconciles the desired configuration with the current state, in this case, the actual deployment, until the two are hopefully equal. The second main big group of operators we see, in my opinion, are operators that try to make some infrastructure reality. So now the current state is no longer inside the cluster as a pod or deployment, but it's actual infrastructure running somewhere else. So for example, would be now very selfishly, I took our own operator at Giant Swarm, AWS operator. The operator has the aim, it gets the definition of a Kubernetes cluster as a CR, and it tries to create that Kubernetes cluster in AWS, the very short form. So what does it do? The AWS operator watches this cluster CR, so custom resource, and it creates Kubernetes clusters on AWS matching that resource. So we are now, instead of managing something inside the cluster, we are managing infrastructure with our operators. But we see the same pattern. It continuously reconciles the desired configuration with now the actual cluster or the actual infrastructure. Now, so far, all of this kind of sounded straightforward, I hope, because the concept should be kind of okay to understand. So now you might ask yourself, well, what makes operators so hard to test? Like, why is this guy holding a talk about testing operators? It seems pretty straightforward. So the focus now shifts towards, yeah, unit tests. We write operators in Go usually. Unit tests are pretty easy. We also have some level of mocking available to us. So there's KDS fake client, which gives you a fake Kubernetes API, stuff like that. But when we go down the chain, we reach a point where we need to write an integration test and maybe a true integration test. And that's where our trouble starts. So as you've observed, operators use external APIs. Especially if you use them for infrastructure management, you have an external API that has like some stateful resources outside of Kubernetes that you now need to somehow interact with. Additionally, they also have a hard dependency on the Kubernetes API. So not only do we have an external API, or in this case, for example, AWS, if we stay with AWS operator, you also, on top of that, have built in the dependency on the Kubernetes API. And now These challenges apply for many other applications, but they get compounded here because we cannot get rid of the Kubernetes API dependency, and we have a very hard dependency possibly on the infrastructure provider. Now, when I describe the loop that tries to make the desired state and the current state equal, so that tries to get the current state to actually match the desired state, we actually have a loop that in reality might never reach a consistent state. So we might try to create a Kubernetes cluster on AWS, but for some reason we cannot do it. It might start failing, or we might just need a long time to reach consistency, and we have sometimes a hard time estimating, well, how long is it going to actually take to get to this desired state, especially if we're managing infrastructure. When we're managing applications like Prometheus operator, the same problem can still exist. As you probably all know, Kubernetes pods can restart all the time. There can be some inconsistencies in that state. So it's not so easy to really define a final state where you can say, okay, the reconciliation has worked completely and I'm super happy with the result. Now, all of this together leads us to a point where if we write integration tests, we often end up in this situation. We have a lot of external APIs that we have a hard time dealing with. We have eventual consistency where we sometimes don't even know if it's going to reach a consistent state. And that leads to this nice picture where we look at our dashboard for our builds and it's just like red and green all over the place. We rerun them like billions of times and we still can't figure out if it's now a bug in our operator, if it's just flapping, what's going on. So this is like a really big problem. And this is also why in open source operators, in my opinion, you very rarely see true integration tests. Might take a closer look at that when you integrate your next operator, how are they integration testing it? And maybe just send me the link if you find one that does it really well, because then I'm very interested. But this problem seems to be not limited to one or two operators, but to many operators. So now, we obviously can make our life a little bit easier. It's not all doom and gloom. There are some ways to make this possible or to at least make flapping less prevalent. And that's something I want to talk about now. Again, this is kind of opinionated from my side. These are best practices that we at Giant Swarm follow and that I would advise you to follow. It's obviously not the silver bullet, because maybe we see later on that there might not be a silver bullet. The first concept I want to talk to you about is finalizers. Who here has used or knows finalizers? It's like three people, two people. Okay, so not many at all. Finalizers are one of the most important concepts when you work with operators, in my opinion. And you will encounter finalizers when you start working with operators or when you start digging into Kubernetes deeper. So what is it actually doing? What is this magical finalizer doing? It basically prevents an object from deletion. What that means is it doesn't prevent everything from the object from deletion. It prevents, for example, the pod YAML description from deletion. The container can already be gone, but your description will stay behind. So the etcd state, which covers like what did the pod look like, will not be deleted until all finalizers are gone. So that basically says the object will only be deleted if the Kubernetes API for finalizers is empty. So there's no finalizers anymore in the object. Then Kubernetes will actually clean up the object and remove it from etcd, and it will be gone when you do like kubectl get pods or whatever. And these deletion events will be replayed over and over again until the finalizer is gone. So in your operator, every reconciliation loop, you will get this deletion event. Why is this so important? We see in a minute, but let's first look at one. A little example here from it's a cluster API type, which I talked about earlier. So this is basically a definition of a cluster. And we can see there's a deletion timestamp. Quick reminder, if a deletion timestamp is set on an object, you know it's deleted. If the deletion timestamp on an object is zero or not there, the object is not deleted. Very easy way for you to tell programmatically or in reality to check is an object actually deleted or is it not in a deleting state? So does Kubernetes think it's deleted or not? So we see there's a deletion timestamp set, so the object is deleted, but we also see two finalizers. So the object in etcd will remain, while everything else can be cleaned up. Now, when we look at this, you can pretty easily tell it's just a list of strings, right? It's just in YAML a list of strings where an operator can write its own name, and then the object will not be deleted. So the very important point over there is controllers and operators should remove themselves from that list if they think this object can be deleted. Now, another very important caveat on this point is if you ever add or remove finalizers, you can do this manually, but if you do it programmatically, that's very important. Make sure and test that you're doing it correctly. Because imagine you are destroying someone else's finalizer, then you end up with leftovers. Because you just said this object can be gone, but there might still be an entire AWS cluster that doesn't now get cleaned up because the operator doesn't know that this object ever existed. So really make sure that the deletion and adding logic for your operator for finalizers is in place. And yeah, that's very crucial unless you want stuff to go wrong. So in conclusion, finalizers are there to basically, with replaying the deletion event, if your operator is down and would miss the first deletion event because you're redeploying it, because there was a bug and it was down for some time, the object will not be gone, but instead when the operator comes back up, the deletion event will continue to be replayed. The operator can then pick up on the deletion event, do its cleanup, remove the finalizer, and you won't have leftovers. So in conclusion, it will improve stability if you use finalizers correctly, in most cases for missed events or different interactions that can go wrong. So in my opinion, especially if there's multiple controllers watching a single event, using finalizers is crucial, and you should never do it without finalizers. The next concept, who has seen a resource version and knows what a resource version is, really quickly? It's maybe one, two people, okay. The resource version is another metadata field you will see in Kubernetes objects. It identifies the state of an object as a number. Now that sounds very crude, like what does that even mean? And it changes only if the object is changed. Now that makes a lot more sense. Let's look at the resource version. You can see down here, name, namespace, resource version. What does this tell you? If you have observed an object and you just saved the resource version, you observe the object again, you match the resource versions. If the resource version changed, then anything in the object can have changed. If the resource version stays the same, the object will be exactly the same. And Kubernetes makes sure of that for you. So the etcd state will not have changed if the resource version stayed the same. Contrary, that also means it can be applied again when updating the object. You can reapply the resource version. And we ensure basically that the object did not change in the meantime. So we can make sure the object we first observe, we did a modification and then apply again, did not change in the meantime, between us observing it and us applying our change. That's very crucial to prevent race conditions. So imagine you read an object, you do some change on the object, in the meantime some other operator did some other, or even a human, did some other modification. You do not check if the object has changed in the meantime and just overwrite this change. You will very quickly run into race conditions where multiple entities can be writing to the same object and never ensuring that their actual change is what they desire to do, because they're just overwriting each other in a race condition. So this is another, in my opinion, very underrated feature that Kubernetes gives you as a developer or as an operations person to ensure that you're preventing race conditions and lots of frustration. Yeah, so it prevents most simple race conditions. Obviously, you can still have race conditions. It's not a silver bullet for race conditions. But it also prevents accidental object manipulation in test suits. Just a quick example, you have a test suit. It manipulates an object and the resource version changed, you can now check actually did just an operation I didn't expect to change my resource version. So did any action take place that I don't know anything about? So this can be some test suite doing something unexpected, some bug in your test suite influencing your test cases, stuff like that. Finally, the status object. Now, I hope a lot of people here know the status object. Is that true? Like, you see the spec and you see the status, right? That's pretty known. The status is a reflection of the current state. So the operator or any operator should write into the status what it thinks is the reality. The spec is the desired state. The status should be the operator's interpretation of this is the reality right now. And now it gets very important that if you write an operator, if you use operators, you can give this maybe as feedback, that the status should reflect error and failure states. Because when you're looking at an object, you want to know, is actually everything going okay? And the status is basically your feedback to say, okay, everything's okay because the operator still thinks it's in an okay state, or it can maybe reflect error and failure states there. Let's look at like a good example, I think, for this would be just the node object in Kubernetes. Obviously, controllers also reconciling the node object. And here we can see it has status conditions. And those conditions very clearly tell you the state of what the operator thinks is going on. So for example, it can say, yeah, okay, I have a last heartbeat time, I have a last transition time, and the message would be Calico's running on this node. Nice. We know Calico's running. Reason Calico's up. Great. Makes sense to me. And status is false. That's not so great. So, well, something went wrong. So this is kind of a reflection of how's it going with your CR. And also when you write an operator, you should take care of transferring information into the status so that someone that's actually using your operator or an open source operator can tell what is going on. Because otherwise, you kind of have to guess, like, what does the operator believe to be the reality when you have just given it a desired state, but maybe it never reaches the desired state. And now the most important sentence of all this should be, if you write a custom resource, if you ever get to the situation where you write an operator, treat your custom resource as an API. So it's just an API. You can define a desired state, and as a response, you don't just get an HTTP response, you get the status, which is just basically the what is the reality. And this becomes your API for your operator. So take care of this API as you would of any other API. So document it, make sure it's nicely usable, make sure anyone can work with it. So yeah, good status implementation is nice. Transition timestamps give performance insights. This is like a quite advanced thing. So now I want to quickly go over some experience now from testing our operators. These are now non-Kubernetes or not purely Kubernetes things, but more like best practices and coding best practices we acquired over time while we were testing our operators and running our operators for now 2 years nearly, or more than 2 years. Number one, never wait during reconciliation. We made this a hard rule. So what can happen is you have a reconciliation loop. So you read an object again, and then you would read the desired state and try to make it a reality. AWS example, you read the desired state. There should be an EC2 instance. You try to create the EC2 instance. What is very easy to do? You add in a backoff. So if the first request to the AWS instance doesn't work, to create the AWS instance doesn't work, you retry maybe 5 times, maybe 10 times. This is a bad practice in our opinion. It just slows down your reconciliation loops. What's way better is just do one request. It fails. You know that the reconciliation will take place again in maybe a minute or whatever your timer was set to. So that makes a lot more sense than retrying and blocking your operator for the time being from any other operation because it's waiting for the requests to come back and it's retrying all the time when you know it's not really time critical if this EC2 instance exists right now or in a minute. So, tests should decide when an action is too long. What does that mean? So we actually monitor like how long does our reconciliation loop take for an object. If it's taking too long, something's going wrong and our test might fail. Because we don't want to get stuck on one object basically for a long time and neglect all the other objects that are building up behind it. So if you have a lot of CRs in a cluster, you suddenly create a bottleneck because your operator takes a very long time just to basically reconcile a single object. And now here you can obviously enforce SLAs in your tests, like to have SLAs, like how quickly should this be done, and monitor them in production. So we actually export metrics from our operators about reconciliation loop times, about different length that are taken there to Prometheus, and then have time series to kind of decide, is this going well or is this going badly? The second thing is now very CI specific. Has anyone heard of Kind? Except the people in my workshop. Okay, yeah, not many people. So you probably all have heard of Minikube though, right? Minikube, a lot of people have heard about. Kind is Kubernetes in Docker. This is what Kubernetes started to build, or people in Kubernetes started to build, because they were so frustrated with Minikube. If you run Minikube in your CI pipeline, you're gonna hit some frustrating pain points. Kubernetes in Docker tries to take them away. It's just Docker. You just need to install Docker. You install Kubernetes in Docker. You can spin up a cluster. What's even better is you can spin up multi-node clusters on your single CI machine because it's just more Docker containers. It's really amazing when you need to test multiple intense scenarios. So now the issues can be very complex in a distributed system. You want your CI pipeline, even in the early stages, to kind of reflect that. So make sure to use Kind, maybe. And another little benefit that's actually so good, in my opinion, is don't settle for some logs. So in Minikube, you might export just some logs, like one or two pods you get the logs out of because you know those are the crucial ones. Kind export logs gives you literally every log that was going on in the cluster, from the API server to every container that has been running to every pod that has been running. So you get all the logs, just write them to your artifact storage. When your build fails, you will be very happy to have all the logs available and just check what actually went wrong. Finally, this is more like a, I would say, culture thing. So what you end up saying when you see this green light, red light, right? You get into a state where you just say, it's just another flap, right? I've seen many flaps in my life. It's just another flap. It's just going to be flapping. The problem isn't really there. And that's getting complacent. Like, there might still be very important issues in your code, but if your integration tests are flapping, you can get very complacent and you can just ignore everything because you lose total trust in all of your integration tests because, like, some of them might be flaking or some of them might be flapping. And this is something where culture in your company, in your team, really needs to be right and pull yourself back up and say, okay, we need to attack this problem. We cannot accept that flapping is still happening in a very large scope. So more cultural thing. So finally, do we have testable Kubernetes operators? Maybe not. They're testable to some degree, and it works out in a reasonable way most of the time. It's still not amazing. Like, it's not the silver bullet. We haven't found the perfect solution for everything. But with the Kubernetes things I showed you and some of the best practices I showed you, at least it was for us possible to reduce flapping and actually have workable Kubernetes integration tests, which I think is already a big improvement over no integration tests. So there's that. So a little bit short, but thank you very much for listening. You can stay in touch with me there. And any questions? Looks like no questions.
Okay. The question, I will come.
Oh, In which infrastructure you testing your operators? You do it with Kind or you do it in reality in a Kubernetes cluster?
We do it step by step. So when we run our operators on Kind, for example, we still let them run against real infrastructure. So an end-to-end test running on Kind will still be configured with a real AWS account, for example, and create all the real resources afterwards. But the integration test is running on Kind, yes, so the operator.
Thanks.
Okay.
So when there's no other question, I have also one question regarding exporting all the logs. How do you scan then all those logs? Because there could be a amount of massive logs when you are exporting all the logs from Kind.
So if you have a lot of logs, then I would reconsider how you cut your integration test. So there should still be only a limited amount of pods running in your integration test, because you can, for an operator, it only really needs the Kubernetes API and the CR to completely test what's happening, right? So the amount of pods running, at least in an integration test for an operator, should be very limited. If it's getting too large, I would start thinking about maybe we are not cutting our APIs correctly because we're creating dependencies that shouldn't be there to integration test it.
Yeah, cool. So it's like limiting or focusing on the stuff. So that's a new question. I will work again.
How you handle some cleaning jobs and if something goes really wrong on this stage?
So if something goes really, really wrong, we have a CI cleaner like was described before. So we have like iterative complete cleanup of our environments. So all the AWS stuff that gets created somewhere just gets purged. Same for Azure, same for the other environments.
Do you use a special account for that, that you can easily...
Yes, we have special accounts for just testing.
Ah, cool.
Cool. There's no more questions. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so...